this day of thresholds, we celebrate new beginnings as we leave behind shadows, shadows of doubt, of fear, and grief. And we embrace the spirit of the season, of becoming, incarnation, and joy. We sing a new song, not only unto the eternal, but unto ourselves. And the song says shalom, which means simply peace and welcome. Well, good morning and happy Easter. Our tradition is a blend of two different groups, the Unitarians and the Universalists. And the Unitarian approach to Easter was that Easter is an opportunity for many lessons about growth, rebirth, and dedication. But for the Universalists, who are symbolized in the symbol up here, there are two rings that connect the realm of the holy and the realm, the kingdom of flesh and blood, the real. And for the Universalists, there are three occasions in the calendar year that are very special. One is Christmas Eve, where they believe that the Word became flesh and that God became a person just like us. And then there's All Souls Day, which is in early November, and they believe that all souls will go to heaven. And then there's Easter, where they believe that the person of Jesus, or Yahshua, rose from the dead and ushered in a whole new time of joy for all people. And one of the key events of the Easter weekend is something called the Last Supper. And this is a picture, it's a classic picture, let me bring it around, painted by Michelangelo. How many of you have ever heard of Michelangelo? Most of you. Da Vinci. That was a test. Da Vinci. And this was painted in a chapel, and eventually, because of the weather, it was worn out, but then it was repainted and made to look vibrant like when he first painted it. Now, what do you notice about this picture? There's Jesus in the center. It's a feast day. It's a meal. He's not eating at the moment. What else do you notice? How many people are there? A lot or a few?
A lot.
A lot. There's actually 13.
Is that the reason we have spaghetti on Easter?
It could well be. We'll find out. And the reason, and one of the reasons why Friday the 13th is considered bad luck is because there were 13 people at the Last Supper on a Good Friday. How many of you knew that? But here's a different picture, and I want you to look at them side by side. And what differences do you notice? This is a picture painted by a Polish artist who was commissioned by a group of Catholic sisters or nuns, and they wanted to portray what they thought was a more realistic picture. And for those of you who have an order of service, it's the same picture printed on the cover. So what you notice is a difference, one difference. Yes,
Nora. The people on that one, they seem so much happier, and they're more vibrant colors. And in that one, it's just plain, and well, the moon's happy in that one, and it's gloomy in that one.
Well, how many women do you see in this picture?
A couple.
In this one here? Zero. There are no women portrayed. In this one, not only are there women portrayed, but also children. And the Last Supper, as it's called in the Christian tradition, was also known as a Seder meal for Passover. And we're going to talk more about the correlation between Passover and Easter among the adults, but for Unitarian Universalists, we don't focus so much upon the death of Jesus or Yahshua. We focus on his life and his teachings. Now, some of his teachings had to do with things that you might expect someone who lives in a small town. They talk about plants, but he also talks about money. So I want to give each one of you one of these. If you'll take one and pass it around, take it and pass it around. Everyone should get one. Hint, there's chocolate in there, but that's for later. So I hold up a coin. Everyone hold up a coin. Everyone's familiar with money. I remember little Charlotte was at our house one day, and she saw a coin, and she burst out giddy and said, "Money!" So even at a tender age, we understand that this is something valuable. So, two of the stories that Jesus told had to do about money, and one of them said, if a person had money and was asked to do something with it, you have different choices. One person would bury it in the ground because he was afraid of losing it. Other people invested it. And at the end of several weeks, all the people who were given money were invited back and asked, well, how much money do you have now? And the people who had invested it made a lot of money and gave back the money to the person that had given it to them. And the person who had buried it had been afraid of losing it. And he was scolded and said, you know, when you're given a gift, you're supposed to use it, not bury it, not hide it, but to use it among other people. But another parable or story is that there were people trying to trick Yashu, and they wanted to know, should we pay our taxes? Now, many of you know that your grown-ups have recently had to struggle with all these paperwork and pay taxes, and nobody likes to pay taxes, not really. And so people were trying to trick Jesus and said, should we pay our taxes? And Jesus said, well, show me a coin. Can you show me a coin? Excellent. And they wanted Jesus to say, no, you should not pay your taxes, in which case he would be a troublemaker for the Romans. But you know what he did? He said, show me a coin. And they gave him a coin. And he said, whose picture is on this? And in the coins of those days, they were the coins of the Roman Empire. The Romans had conquered Palestine 100 years before. And so the only money that was good there had Caesar on it. Caesar was the king. And so when he showed it back to them and said, whose picture is on here? And they said, well, it's Caesar's. And he handed back the coin and says, well, if it's Caesar's coin, you should give it back to him. But if you have something that belongs to God or the Spirit, you should give that back to God or the Holy Spirit. And it's one of the great lessons that we read in the gospel narratives, the stories about Jesus that have been handed down for 2,000 years. And for Unitarian Universalists, it's those stories that make him a remarkable person. And if you were to ask a typical Unitarian Universalist about who was Yashu or who was Jesus, an honest, good answer would be he was a religious genius, much like Buddha and some of the other great teachers of the ages. You have a question?
Caesar is actually called Julius Caesar.
Julius Caesar was actually one of the Caesars. In the time of Jesus, it was actually Tiberius. There were a whole series. One last question, then I'll dismiss you for your classes.
Can we eat our coin now?
You can eat your coin now. Yes. In Paris this week, a great cathedral burned. Days before, three churches, African-American, burned in the South. This morning, several churches were bombed and burned in Sri Lanka. Each act is a reminder that a building by itself is but a structure made out of brick and mortar, and that what we truly celebrate, what we mourn in such instances, is the loss of life and the hardship inflicted upon those, especially for the churches in the South and in the hotel and churches of Sri Lanka this morning. And so we often differentiate between the church, the building, and the church, the people, or the church, the movement. And when we speak of Jesus, or more properly, Yashu, we talk of a moment in time where something happened within the Jewish tradition, where Yashu began to follow in the footsteps of Hillel, the first great Reformed rabbi. To be a rabbi back in those days did not mean that you had an advanced degree from an established and well-known institution, but that you were recognized by your peers and others as a person possessing great wisdom. Hillel, who lived approximately 100 years before Yashu, had been tested by people who said, "Tell us, what is the whole summation of the law," meaning the Torah, "while I stand on one foot?" And Hillel is said to have responded, "That's very simple, to love God with all of your heart, all of your soul, and to love your neighbor as yourself." No doubt that when Jesus began to speak the word, he was recognized as someone who was a religious genius, someone who, by virtue of his wisdom and the clarity of his thought, was a marvel, a child prodigy. We are told that as a child he spoke in the temples and the elders were amazed. We, in our own time and lives, have witnessed other prodigy. I think of Clayton Winmore Penrose as one. Someone who, at a very young age, demonstrated a remarkable command over a particular thing. In Clayton's case, music. In the case of Yashu, the wisdom of the law. Now, for Unitarian Universalists, as I mentioned to the youth, there are several high holy days that, due to our tradition, that we lift up and we celebrate: Christmas Eve, All Souls Day, and yes, even Easter. But when we speak of Easter, the Unitarian Universalist minister wakes up with a sense of discomfort, because whereas most of our cousins in other Christian movements talk about a resurrection from the dead, more often than not, we speak about the renewal of life, and we point to various living metaphors like flowers that spring back after a long, hard winter. But renewal is not the same as resurrection. And in fact, resurrection is a concept quite removed from contemporary universalism. That which is dead does not come back into life. If it was dormant, perhaps. If it was stilled, if it was comatose, perhaps. But if it was truly dead, it does not come back. And so when we approach an occasion like Easter, we refocus our attention on the religion of Jesus, the religion that he himself practiced, versus the religion about Jesus. And it's to create a safe space for those who are natural skeptics and people who have been wounded in their faith journey by so many people and so many institutions. When we talk about the religion about Jesus, we talk about an individual who had a supernatural birth, born of an unwed virgin, and then we skip along to his end, where he had a supernatural death. When we speak about the religion of Jesus, we dismiss the superstitions attached at either end of his life story, and we focus on, in fact, the story of his life, his teachings, his example, how he mentored, how he welcomed others into his company, be they children, lepers, women, those who had been pushed back by respectable society. But he welcomes them and embraces them and says, "For you too are the children of the Most High, just like me." And the examples of prayer that he shared with them began with words like this: "Our Father." And that's a very important phrase, because never in his life and in the Testament does he say that God is only his Father, but is the Father of all living creatures. And he does not say that he is the Son of God, but he is credited with saying, "I am the Son of Man," which is a very different thing indeed. For each one of us is a human being. And in the language of that time, to say that you are a child, the Son of Man, is to say that you are a human being. And that's a remarkably different thing than what is taught as Orthodox religion in so many other places. But if you study the progression of the Christian movement through the centuries, you see that it began as a very simple movement with followers of Jesus who literally left behind their work and their homes and were called to a new mission. Let the dead bury the dead, he said. Follow me. And there were, his words and his message were laced with urgency. There is no time. And in that way, he continued the ministry of John the Baptist, who said, the kingdom of God is within, but the judgment of God is imminent. And in fact, during that time, 100 years after the Roman conquest of Palestine by the Roman general Pompey, that part of the world was bristling with energy and resentment against their Roman overlords. It is one of the unfortunate facts of history that that piece of the world has stood in the crossroad of great empires, from the Egyptians to the Macedonians to the Babylonians and the Romans. And in each instance, there was a conquest, a great slaughter, and many, many rebellions, most of which were people were crushed and destroyed. But the hope for freedom, for liberation from their oppressors, continued to breathe through their history and through their scriptures. And when they celebrated their seders, they remembered a time when they were freed from their overlords in Egypt. And they were free to leave their bondage and free to seek a new life and build a new community and to follow their God as they understood it. Fast forward through the generations, and on Good Friday, so-called, Jesus and his disciples, men, women, and children, gathered for a Seder meal to celebrate, once again, that old story of liberation. But in the decades following his death, that story of the Final Supper with his friends and family began to morph into something quite different. And from a meal to commemorate the old and a tale of liberation, it became a new story about a pathway to salvation. And liberation and salvation are not quite the same thing, just like renewal and rebirth are not quite resurrection. And a great divorce began to happen within the Christian movement. The initial followers of Jesus, or Yashu, included his brother, James, so-called, who understood that Jesus had been a genius and had called people to return to God in the belief that the end of the world was imminent and that God was going to intervene in human history and overthrow the Romans and return this sacred land back to the chosen people. It was actually a common belief in those days. In the stories told, in the histories written by Josephus, who was a Jewish general in the service of the Romans, he recorded that there were actually about a dozen individuals, all men, who began to preach about God's intervention in history and called followers to themselves, went to the desert, performed miracles, including raising the dead, and in each instance, they were all slain by the Romans. Jesus is the only person in those histories who is named. And a much later scribe, a medieval Christian scribe, included the phrase that he was Jesus, the Son of God. But in the earliest contemporaries of Yashu, that was not part of the theology. That was not part of the spirituality of being Jewish. It would have been considered an aberration. And Unitarian and Universalist scholars, when they have combed through the ancient scriptures over the past 400 years, have looked at the charges levied against Jesus. And it is quite remarkable that that none of the charges by either the Romans or the priests or anyone else involved in his conviction ever claimed that he claimed to be God. That claim came from a much later time and a much later understanding, heavily influenced by Paul and the Greek philosophers. And so if we return to the religion of Jesus, or Yashu, We understand that his mother's name was Miriam, the same Miriam who is celebrated in the Passover Seder as the sister of Moses. We understand that the sharing of bread, the unleavened bread, the drinking of wine, is part and parcel of a very powerful Jewish ritual. And that everything that is attributed to Jesus can actually be explained either as something which has just grown with the retelling over the generations, or as something other. 30 years ago, I was a chaplain at Northwestern in Chicago. And I was called to visit various patients, one of whom happened to be Jewish. And he was delighted to find that his chaplain for the day was a Unitarian. And he said, "There's something I've been meaning to talk to someone about, and I'll talk with you." And he had been pondering the miracles of Jesus. And he said, "I have puzzled long and hard over the story about the loaves and the fishes and how Jesus fed the multitudes. Here's what I think really happened," he said. "Imagine that you are living in that day and age, and that you know that Jesus is going to be speaking outside the city limits in a desperately hot climate. And people flock, solitary or in families, to go and hear this preacher. Then, as now, you don't go empty-handed. We would pack a sack lunch, they would bring food with them and water. And then they would go and listen for however long it took. And at some point, it was brought to Jesus' attention that people had run out of food, or they hadn't brought enough for themselves. As Jesus," he said, "imagine this, that he holds up a piece of bread and holds up some fishes, breaks them, and hands them out to his disciples. And by example, others got the point, we're supposed to share our food. And that's what they did." Now that to me seems a perfectly reasonable explanation. And I'm satisfied that if in fact there was a miracle of the loaves and fishes, it was getting other people to share their food. It's still remarkable in our day and time. But I'm concerned, as I have studied the evolution of the Christian movement, to see what has in effect been the erasure of the Jewishness of Jesus and his original followers. They're often called the first Christians, as if they had intended to start something brand new. Whereas we know that actually they consider themselves Jewish followers, followers of the law, and that they understood that when Jesus spoke to them, it was not to change the law or to dismiss the law, but to add a new insight, much as Hillel had done. And we know that in that day and age, there was much tension between those who had studied and become rabbis and were encouraging the celebration of Jewish rituals in each person's home versus those who had power in the temple, who earned their livelihood and their living by all the offerings brought to the temple. And we know that until the destruction of the temple, that the tension between these two groups was reaching a boiling point. And when the Romans destroyed the temple in what we would calculate as the year 70 of the Christian or Common Era, Judaism changed dramatically. There are, of course, those in our day and age who pine for the reconstruction of a temple. Usually they are Christians, Christian fundamentalists, who are looking for the end of times once again. Not so that the Jewish faith and people will be celebrated, but that's so that God can become incarnate again and destroy all those who disbelieved, including those who are Jewish. But we've seen in the passage of time, so even the names ascribed to that original genius and his followers had to be changed to make it non-Jewish. And the rituals, such as Passover, had to be changed into something new, like the Good Supper. And the Sabbath, worshipped on a Saturday, had to be changed to a Sunday. And bit by bit, word by word, sacrament by sacrament, that which was Jewish was transformed over the millennia into something quite different. And the Jews became those who had rejected Jesus, the people who were stubborn, the people who, when they read, literally read backwards, compared to those who write in an English or Roman script from back to front. And so it became very easy to make those who were Jewish the scapegoats against Christianity. And in time after time, the Crusades assailed Jewish people and their sacred temples as much as they did those who were Muslim. I was reminded that Good Friday in Russia used to be the most unholy of days if you were Jewish, because it was an occasion of license for Christians to go and to perform pogroms against the Jewish communities, to kill, to maim, to slaughter, and to burn down without impunity. Erasure has been on my mind these past few months as we talk about people who were colonized by others, either in this hemisphere or in the old hemisphere, people who fought to retain their identity, their language, their rituals, their sacred songs. And far too often we remember those who are indigenous on this continent and we neglect those from other climes, in particular the original Hebrews of that land. One wonders how Jesus, in his own time, would have understood the celebration of Easter in our time, to see how certain symbols, such as the egg, which was a symbol of life, something encrusted in a hard shell, but served during the Passover Seder, served after every funeral service, had been co-opted by a new movement into a celebration of fertility and then for the welcoming of spring, something quite disparate and disconnect. We wonder about how people would have understood in the Gospel of John how he proclaimed, "In the beginning was the Word," and understand that over the millennia, the Word in the Greek tradition meant Sophia or wisdom, but in the Jewish tradition from which this concept sprang, referred to the Torah, or the sacred word of God. One wonders how Jesus would have responded to a movement which claimed to establish churches, when we know today that those who were raised Jewish flinch when they hear that word, even in Unitarian Universalist communities. And people would, they would much prefer that we stuck to the truth, which are we are congregations and not churches, because church is a Christian-specific word. If we look at those teachings, as many preachers have done over the past millennia, and if we focus on them, and if we celebrate the origins of Jesus and the roots of the traditions which have been spread throughout the world, there's much richness. There is no reason to co-opt. There's no reason to denigrate another tradition. In Unitarian Universalist circles, up until about 20 years ago, it was quite common that at this time of year, we would turn to a Unitarian Universalist Haggadah, or order service, and have a UU Seder. Over the last 20 years, that has been retired because it's been considered an abuse of another's tradition. You cannot imagine how angry people get when you press another's rituals and sacred words and songs into the service of someone else. Some years ago, one of the rabbis in town had heard a rumor that I was going to perform a bat mitzvah. And he asked me directly, "Is this true? Could it possibly be true?" And I told him, "Absolutely not." Because I understand very firmly that there are boundaries that separate the different traditions, and that it is a gross violation for one person to go into another's and to steal or borrow, even with the best of intentions. Likewise, some years before, I had attended a Unitarian Universalist religious education conference, and a number of guests had been invited, and the focus of that particular gathering was Native American spirituality. And individuals who were from one nation up in Wisconsin were invited, and they were very worried that they were going to perform sacred rituals and that this was going to be stolen, as so many other things have been stolen over the centuries by white people who were then going to enact them and claim to be Native American practitioners. And even though we insisted that we're not like that, we're Unitarian Universalists, we respect other people, it took all of that week to impress upon them our best intentions, and even then, they respectfully declined. Would that in searching for the historic Jesus, for the Jewish Jesus, the traditions over the millennia had the same sense of reservation and respect. And so on this Easter, this festival of Passover, Pesach, Pascha, we can remember that there is a conflation of different traditions, even within our own, and that there's been much misappropriation. And we would do well to remember that heritage and to honor it, and those who celebrate the original heritage that Jesus himself celebrated, but to recognize that even against his own understanding, something new was born and began to spread, and to recognize and to tease out the good from the bad from that newer tradition, and to understand that actually there is no monolith in Judaism or in Christianity, but that even in communities that call themselves Unitarian Universalists, you can honor the individual and celebrate Easter, even if you do not accept all of the mythology that accompanies it. And so, once again, my thoughts turn to a rabbi, a handy worker who was infused with the spirit of his day, who understood that the end of times was coming and that people were called to repent. And even if all did not come to pass as he predicted, it is still a worthwhile mentor to understand that we are constantly yearning for something above and beyond us, a life of the Spirit, and that the kingdom of heaven is inside each one of us if we will only listen. And that, my friends, is the great gift of this day and this holiday, to remember that the Spirit of the Holy is alive and well, but is not to be found out there, but within each other, even the person next to you. Amen and blessed be. For our closing words, I offer you this meditation by Unitarian Universalist Minister Mark Bellatini. Let us go in peace. Let us live simply, gently, at home within ourselves. Let us choose to act justly and to speak justly. Let us remember the depths of our own compassion and forget not our power in the days of our powerlessness. Let us not desire to be wealthier than our peers and stint not our hands of charity. Let us practice forbearance. Let us speak the truth or speak not. Let us take care of ourselves as bodies, for this is a good gift. Finally, let us crave peace for all the people in the world, beginning with ourselves. And as we go, let us go with the dream of that peace alive in each of our hearts. Amen and blessed be.